equipping effective advocates for family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. You can be better informed, more motivated, and more effective. Subscribe to our fact-filled newsletter, follow us on Facebook, check out our YouTube channel, listen to our podcasts, and keep up to date with all of our projects at ruthinstitute.org. Father Paul Sullins is once again a guest of Molly Smith on Salem Radio's From the Median. They're discussing the tragic problem of clergy sexual abuse and misconduct in the Catholic Church in light of the recent USCCB audit, which is the subject of Father Sullins' latest report.
Welcome to From the Median, a daily report from the front line of the pro-life movement, discussing two worldviews that are driving our culture in opposite directions. From the Median asks, which side of the road are you on? What direction do you want our culture to go? Tune in as we plan the route that takes us back to the culture of life. And now your host, Molly Smith.
Good evening and welcome to From the Median, where we are concerned with the middle ground, not just to understand both sides of an argument, but also to awaken the consciences of those who are neutral or indifferent to this, the greatest civil rights movement of all times, the pro-life movement. Listeners, wonderful to have you with me again this evening, and welcome again, as I said at the beginning. I want to just say that I am very honored this evening to have a returning guest with us, Father Paul Sullins, who is a senior research fellow with the Ruth Institute. And I've got him back on the program again because he has just put out a very, very important report. Father Paul Sullins is very well known throughout the world. In fact, his reports have rocked the world in many instances. I know he's been talking to people all over the world about his findings on sexual abuse amongst Catholic priests. And without any further ado, welcome to the program, Father Paul.
Hello, Molly. It's wonderful to be with you.
It's great to have you here. And you know what? A sad thing the reason why we have you with us, but I think it's right. Also a very, very cleansing. Your reports are really very cleansing for many people because you are shining the light into the corners and exposing what is actually happening within the Catholic Church when it comes to the sexual abuse problems that we've had now for decades. You've yeah. just very recently put out in July of this month, you've put out a report. And it's the findings from the 2019 annual report from the National Review Board of the United States Catholic Conference of Bishops.
Right.
What were you expecting? Let's start off there. We know that there was sexual abuse. We knew that this was happening. And what were you expecting that they would find, Father Sullins?
Well, at first, we should give credit to the bishops and to the charter process for forcing themselves to produce this audit report each year. It's probably not the most popular thing that they do. It is something that gives us a measure, a yardstick, as to how much abuse has been occurring, how much new abuse has been discovered, and how well the dioceses and the bishops are doing to help keep children safe and to help repair the damage from the past. Now, remember, in 2004, the John Jay report was published following sex abuse scandal of 2002, where we found out that a great deal of sex abuse had been going on under our noses, as it were, in the Catholic Church by priests, and it kind of exploded. And just to set a context for the report I'm about to talk to, that John Jay report revealed 14,817 total incidents of sex abuse by 4,392 priests and involved 10,667 victims. So each year since then, the audit report has reported new allegations, new perpetrators, and new victims. And for the past several years, they have been fairly small compared to the avalanche that was revealed in this latest report. So it's probably hard to do on the radio, but I would like the listeners to just imagine. I mean, I have all these charts. The Ruth Institute is going to have a summit next week, a conference, and I'm going to be presenting a lot of charts. People could go and look at it online and get this material. In fact, you could go to the Ruth Institute website, and you can get the charts that I'm going to be trying to describe to you right now. One of the measures is the number of allegations that have been revealed, and the allegations in, let's start with 2016. They were up from 2015. There were 1,318. In 2017, 693. In 2018, it went up 1,455. And the report said, look, that's more than twice as many as the year before, but in 2019, it was, guess how many? 4,434 new allegations.
Wow.
Three times as many as in 2018, which was already twice as many. So it's a flood of new incidents. Now, remember what kicked this all off? The John Jay report, it was only 14,000 and just under 15,000. So we have now, in just last year, we've learned about between a fourth and a third new allegations compared to the a number that we learned of in 2004 that kicked off all of the concern that we have.
Wow.
If you look at offenders, the perpetrators, it's even worse because each year they get allegations against new perpetrators, right? So again, I'm going to give you this progression from 2016. We learned of 141 new perpetrators. So these are allegations against priests that had not received any allegation before. 2017, it was 353. 2018, 421. Last year, 1,934 newly accused priests.
Wow.
Now, each year they substantiate a number of the allegations and they remove priests from ministry. They permanently removed. And that's also something that we should value and celebrate as part of the charter.
Sure.
Process takes place. But we see the same progression. In fact, it's even more dramatic. In 2016, there were 25 priests permanently removed from ministry. 2017, it was 33. 2018, it was 30. Last year, 142.
Wow.
Catholic priests permanently removed from ministry. These are priests that we didn't know about before or that we had learned about in the past 2 years, and their allegations were substantiated and they were removed. There's another, I forget the number, I think 60 or so, that have been temporarily removed from ministry while they're investigating the allegations. The bottom line for this, the summary for this report is that it's far larger than any previous report that we've had,
wow,
reporting the amount of abuse that's been happening in the Catholic Church. Now, a lot of this is a consequence of the revelations of 2018 when we had the Pennsylvania Grand Jury report, and just before that we learned of Cardinal McCarrick, a former Cardinal McCarrick now. And we were shocked that this was still going on to the extent that it was. And as a result, several states changed their laws to relax their standards of limitations either permanently or for a period of time, and to allow grand juries to be impaneled to investigate whether there had been abuse going on in their dioceses. In New York State particularly, there are a number of these investigations that have occurred. And so a lot of these new incidents have been dredged up, not by the church, not by the bishops, but they've been dredged up by the civil legal processes as victims become empowered and victims come forward and they make their reports. We also have each year a certain amount of current abuse, that is allegations that young people make or their parents make, of minor children that are currently being abused by Catholic priests. And that also went up in the past year.
Wow.
Not as dramatically, but it went up by about 40%. The average from 2015 to 2018 is 25, and in 2019 it was 37 reports of current abuse. So this is very small compared to the amount of abuse that we know of that occurred back in the 1980s.
But it's still going on. Yeah.
But it's still going on. So it's a special concern to us because it's not something that's in the past that we can say, well, we can't do anything about it. This is something that's happening right now. We have put into place all of these procedures to keep children safe in the Catholic Church. But the amount of current abuse tells us that there are places where those procedures aren't working. There are gaps in the process that aren't happening that should be happening.
Father Sullins is a research scientist. He's incredibly good at it, and he's actually become renowned. His work has become renowned around the world. Father Sullins is with the Ruth Institute, and he, if you go to the Ruth Institute's website, you can pull down all of his reports, and you can actually see some of his graphs and studies that he's done and how he's broken down the information that he has come out of this 2019 report. He's also going to be speaking at Father Sullins. Tell us the date that you're going to be at the conference that you're going to be talking at.
July 17 and July 18. If I don't have okay. that, if I'm not misreading that.
Okay, that's fine.
It's going to be next Friday and Saturday in Lake Charles, Louisiana, and people can certainly come. And hear about this report. I'm going to be speaking about this report mostly on Saturday, I believe will be July 18.
If I'm not mistaken, is this not also going to be available online? Your presentations, I think, Dr. Jennifer said something about that.
Yes, they'll be available online. Yeah. Right now, the written report, the short report that I've made is available online, and then I'll be expanding that and going into much more depth on July 18th. And not only can people get it following July 18th, but you can actually register for and be present for the live stream on July 18th. As we do nowadays, of course, most conferences are remote, and people can sit in the safety of their own homes and participate.
Perfect.
Almost as well as being there in person, I suppose.
Sure.
But it's you certainly get a lot more depth and detail. So I'd encourage people who want that to just go look up RuthInstitute.org and find out more about these conferences.
Good.
Now,
good.
You asked a great question at the end of the last segment, Molly, and that was about the priests that have been accused are determined not to have been credibly accused, to have been falsely accused. And so I want to say that each year that happens. I would say that a majority, maybe a bare majority of all of the allegations that are received each year are determined within that year or subsequently not to be credible not to be pertinent. Now, a lot of the accusations are against priests who are deceased, most of them, or maybe at least half of them, are additional allegations against priests that have already received allegations in the past. So that's priests that either have been determined to be abusers or have been exonerated already. So the allegations against new priests, newly accused priests, go through a process of determination each year. And they are first assessed whether or not it's a credible allegation. That's a sort of a canonical process that takes place in the church. And it's a kind of a minimal review to see if, you know, the dates match, if it's reasonable to think that this might have occurred. And following that, a number of allegations are considered not to be possible. And then all of those that are deemed to be credibly accused are reported to the civil authorities, and the civil authorities go through their own determination and whether it can be substantiated or unsubstantiated, and then whether it can lead to civil action or criminal action against that person. Now, a lot of the allegations that are deemed to be credible, nonetheless, don't necessarily lead to criminal charges because there are very high standards, sometimes statutes of limitations and other things that apply in those cases. So the charter did stipulate that priests that have been accused should have the same level of rights as accusers have. And so priests that have been accused are supposed to have the presumption of innocence. They're supposed to be the subject of a adversarial process where they can defend themselves. And if they're found not to be guilty, then they can be restored to ministry. Typically, a priest is removed from ministry once an allegation is made, either temporarily or permanently, and then the process of adjudication goes forth, and it goes into lots of different probable outcomes. Priests, for instance, may or may not be removed from the clerical state, depending on the outcome.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes a priest is not removed from ministry. There's a small proportion that are kept in ministry while the allegations are being adjudicated. In 2019, I was trying to look the number up and I didn't get there, but it's somewhere around 40 priests that are still in active ministry and are the subject of allegations. The reason they do that is because we found over the years that once a priest is accused, if he's exonerated, it's often hard to restore his good name to the extent that he had a good name before that. There are a number of people that are going to consider him just by the virtue of having been accused to be guilty. It turns out not to be fair to priests that are falsely accused.
Exactly.
Now, should we allow priests to stay in active ministry while they're being
investigated, so to speak?
Investigated, or not? I don't really have a good answer to that. You have to think how many perpetrators do you want to allow to remain in ministry? Then they're discovered that the
that it was valid,
substantiated, and subsequently exactly. removed. How much danger do you want to create for future possible victims?
Exactly.
Or as opposed to how much damage do you want to do to innocent priests and to their reputation?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's a very difficult sort of fine line to walk down.
Yes.
Because, I think we all know of priests who were left in ministry and the allegations are found to be substantiated. And then you have to then start wondering about all the children and all the people that have been involved in that.
Right.
But then exactly. And I mean, all of us know priests who have been accused and who they've never ever were able to find anything against them. And these priests, as you say, their names are irreparably damaged because their reputations are.
Right.
So it's a very hard thing. However, let's look at, the actual allegations.
In 2019, there were 34 priests that are still in active ministry pending investigation. Speaking as a priest, when you become a priest, you offer your life to God in a special way, and are willing to lay down that life. I think if I was accused, credibly accused of sexual abuse, God forbid, but if I were, I would want to be removed from ministry for the good of the church.
Yes, exactly.
During that time, even though if I was exonerated, which I hope I would be, it would be hard to recover my personal status or the reputation that I had before. I understand that. But I would really, I really wouldn't want to give any cause for someone to think that children were at risk. It's also true that later on, when the public hears about these things in the church, one of the most offensive things, in fact, one of the most offensive things to Catholics, is not so much that this abuse went on, because in a human world, you're going to have people who are going to engage in horrible behavior like this, but that it was covered up, and,
exactly.
And the priests were not, were moved from parish to parish, were not removed promptly enough. So I think that that's a huge part of the scandal that we're enduring as Catholics today. So
exactly.
For the sake of that, I would want to say personally, I can't speak for anyone else, but for me, I'd say, look, yank me out. And
do your investigation. Exactly right. And I think that is that you have to err on the side of caution when it comes to this kind of stuff, because you're talking about, you know, the lives of families. The whole family gets impacted by this type of behavior. So, you know, whether it's whether it was not, substantiated or whether it was, regardless, there is something going on, and we need to, you know, as a priest, you're so right, Father Sullins, because as a priest, it's like, what is your first duty is to be the shepherd to the people around you. So all of the information that Father Paul Sullins is actually talking about right now, he is our guest this evening, all of his information and his graphs and all the things that we are discussing can be found on the Ruth Institute's website. So you can go there too. And if you are listening to this program, which I often do, if I get a great program like this, I will replay it again and it'll be re-aired. So, you can go onto their website. If the date for the convention that he mentions in the last segment has gone by and you've said, oh, darn, I didn't get to it. I know that they will be putting up a lot of information about that conference up on their website. And then remember to look for the next one, because I know Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morses, who is the president of the Ruth Institute, always got some fun things going on in their organization. So just remember to do that. Father Sullins, what kind are you finding, as I mentioned in the last segment, let's look at who are the victims of this sexual abuse within the church. Are we finding that it is still predominantly male, which it seemed to be originally, but that there are also some females being involved in this now?
It's unlike the abuse that happened in the 1980s, which was about 90% of the victims were young males, not prepubescent males. It was not mostly pedophilia. It was mostly male-on-male predation. If they call it ephebophilia or call it well, call it whatever you want. Mm-hmm. It was mostly young boys approaching or past puberty, but it was still minors in the 1980s. That is not true today. Today, the victims that are reported by the USCCB audit reports are about evenly male and female. 47%, 45 to 47% over the last 20 years of the victims have been boys. And the vast majority of the victims, both boys and girls, have been older than they were in the 1980s. The median age of victims in the past 20 years have been 14. So they've been older, and much more female. You mentioned the Ruth Institute, and I did a more extensive analysis of this using more complete data than is reported in the audit reports. And in that report, it's called Receding Waves, and people can go to the Ruth Institute website or just Google Receding Waves and Ruth Institute and pull it up. There's a figure. It's figure 5. It shows the proportion of victims from the 1950s up through 2011. And it shows that after the year 2000, the proportion of male victims began to fall rapidly. So by 2011, there was actually a minority of male victims, under 40% by those measures. So it's a different kind of abuse. It's not related to sexual orientation, like the abuse in the past. Now, I'm really pleased to see this because it confirms what I predicted from my earlier models, that we are not ordaining very many, if any, homosexual men today. Most of the homosexual abuse or male-on-male abuse, if you want to call it that, is by older priests that were ordained in earlier decades. Our younger priests today are not involved in sex abuse, hardly at all.
Homosexual abuse,
any kind of sexual abuse.
Oh, wow, good.
Back in the 1980s, recently ordained priests, that's priests ordained within the last 10 years, perpetrated most of the abuse. By that same measure today, recently ordained priests perpetrate only a very small proportion of the abuse. It's mostly priests that have been ordained for a longer period of time. And that's consistent with my findings that we have today in the Catholic Church a cohort of priests that have a high proportion of homosexual men over age 65. So my reports show that, or my models estimate that, in the United States today, among priests 65 and older, about 1 in 4 are same-sex attracted. But that's not true for priests. If you look at priests under age 50 today, it's only maybe 1 in 30 or even less that I would estimate to be same-sex attracted by the same model. So we have this kind of generational divide among our priests that is before and after 2002. And if you remember, after 2002, the Pope Benedict reasserted the Church's teaching that discipline that homosexual men were not eligible to be ordained, should not be ordained. That has been the Church's policy very clearly since the early 1960s, and he reaffirmed that. And I think that a lot of the people involved in formation and a lot of the bishops took that to heart. And there's not evidence that kind of ordination is going on. Now, I know people tell stories and say, well, I know this priest and I know these. And so we can know some. So I can't say definitively that there are none.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
If you look at the numbers as a whole, it's hard to find.
We are going in. It's going in the right direction from that perspective.
Absolutely.
So it's
maybe small comfort to say, well, it's not the wrong kind of abuse, or it's not the same kind of abuse that it was. But that's true. It involves more females by far than it did in the 1980s.
Exactly. And now we get to that other whole issue because, of course, we've all of us, and whether it is a Catholic priest or a Christian pastor from any other denomination, we do know that this is a huge problem. I know the Southern Baptist Convention was dealing with a lot of issues with the same sort of thing. But for them, it was mainly female abuse, you know, by their male pastor. So I know, I mean, I've spoken to people within the Southern Baptist, and I know that that's also the case there. And of course, it doesn't give you any solace to think that your daughters then may be at risk from this. But there is, as you say, you know, the homosexual issue is something that the Church is fighting and that we as a society are fighting against, because it is against God's will. And if you're a Christian, whether you like it or not, that is what God teaches. That is what, you know, that's what the Bible teaches. That's what Christ taught. I mean, the whole thing. So we know that. But now we're talking about female abuse. You know, there was looks like that this is where it's going much more now. And from what I'm understanding you to say in the previous segments is that this abuse is not going away in any big way.
No, it's not going away. Yeah. In fact, the large spike of male-on-male abuse that happened in the 1980s kind of hid from us the fact that there has been a continuing amount of male-on-female abuse since the 1960s in the Catholic Church. And as I show in this second report that I'm talking about, the receding waves report, That percentage has been very constant. We've had a small but persistent amount of abuse of girls in the Catholic Church, and that's the abuse that we're seeing today. It's as if the male-on-male abuse has washed away, and what's left is the male-on-female abuse that's been there all along, and we're seeing today. What's concerning is that it's increasing, or it seems it may be increasing, according to these latest reports. You can say, well, we have so many new reports coming out from lawsuits and grand juries that, of course, we're going to find prior abuse. And yeah, that's true, but it doesn't follow that we're going to find current abuse coming out from lawsuits and grand juries. So the increase in current abuse are people that are reporting young people who are coming forward and saying, I'm being abused right now. That's of a particular concern. Report has an introduction by the National Review Board. So another good thing of the charter is that it established an independent lay board to kind of respond to and in some ways oversee what the bishops and the dioceses were doing. And so that board has published kind of an assessment of the audit report. And you can read it. It's a letter from the chair. It's about 2 to 3 pages long, single space that is published along with the report.
Mm-hmm.
And that draws attention to a number of problems, a number of gaps and loopholes in the report. In fact, the audit firm, Stonebridge firm, that goes and audits the dioceses each year, started reporting about 5 years ago that there was slippage in the diligence of dioceses and bishops.
Father Sullins, let's look at that letter that was sent to the introductory letter. As you mentioned, I did read it. It's very comprehensive, and it does lay out some very important things that we've got to be aware of.
Right. Well, the report calls attention to complacency on the part of the bishops. In fact, the Stonebridge audit firm, since about 2015 or so, has a section of the report that's headed complacency, and they detail incidents after instance of going to dioceses and finding that they're not prepared to undergo the audit. They haven't implemented all of the procedures. They're not aware of some of the things that may be going on in their dioceses and so forth. The National Review Board, NRB, in its preliminary letter, points out a couple of things that are of concern. I've already mentioned the rate of current abuse that's going on, and they point that out, and they say that until we do something about the current abuse, we can't say that this problem is something that is in the past. The amount of current abuse, even though it's small compared to the past, makes clear, and I'm quoting now from their report, from their introduction, quote, makes clear that the sexual abuse of minors in the church is not a thing of the past, but continues to be an issue that requires the undivided attention and energy of the bishops.
Mm-hmm.
They say that because the other features of the report strongly suggests that this issue is not having the undivided energy and attention of all the bishops, or too many bishops that it doesn't have. So they have a couple of recommendations. The first recommendation has to do with a loophole in the charter process. The charter requires dioceses to be audited, to take a review of their procedures and what's going on in the year to make sure that they're still doing a good job. But there's nothing that requires a diocese to do the same thing with regard to the parishes in that diocese. And so often if you audit a diocese and they'll say, well, we think we're doing a good job, but they don't really know because they haven't collected information from the parishes. It's just kind of happenstance. The report reports that about 40% of dioceses do not have at least a minimal parish audit system. And so it warns us that until every diocese implements parish audits, it's difficult to conclude that a diocese has indeed established a culture of safety. In last year's report, they were a little more explicit. They said it seems to be that some bishops are just trying to check off the boxes instead of actually implementing and keeping up with these procedures to ensure that a safe environment for children is actually being implemented in their parishes. So one thing that we could do would be to encourage dioceses to implement parish audits if they haven't. Now, one of the problems in the audit reporting system is that it doesn't identify which dioceses are or are not complying with these different recommendations. And so we don't know which 40% of dioceses those are. It would be a great improvement, in my opinion, if they would name these dioceses. These dioceses have parish audits. These don't.
Exactly.
And then we would have more sunshine and could do something about it. But it's possible for Catholics in dioceses to ask the diocesan staff, ask the bishop, ask the sexual abuse coordinator. Most dioceses have a person that is in that role. Say, do we do parish audits? And to try to take a look at what is done. It could be very minimal. It could be more extensive. So the Stonebridge Audit Firm and the National Review Board both strongly encourage all of the dioceses to have parish audits. They've been encouraging this for 20 years. In this report from this past year, it seems even more important that loophole be filled. And then there's another loophole, and that is that the charter required all priests and diocesan employees to undergo background checks so that they could be checked against criminal records and other records to ensure that they did not have a history of being involved in sex abuse.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And every diocese has done that, but it didn't require them to do it again. So after 18 years, there are instances where the background checks have not been renewed in the dioceses. Also, the charter required safe environment training, both for children and for adults, but it didn't require ongoing training, just one time. So 3/4 of the dioceses do ongoing training, 85% do renew the background checks, but that means that 1/4 of dioceses are not requiring ongoing training, and 15% are not requiring the renewal of background checks. Those are very serious loopholes because
exactly.
We know that predators will ingratiate themselves in parishes and will avoid these kind of checks.
Checks and balances, exactly. Exactly.
Yeah.
No, absolutely.
Yeah.
And you know, I in the final couple of minutes here, I wanted to say, if somebody wanted to find out, how do we know if our diocese, who people listening to the program now, how do we know whether or not our diocese is compliant? And then secondly, as you mentioned, are our parishes, you know, that's the reach out and touch somebody is the parish. So is the parish doing something? How do we find that information out?
Right. Unfortunately, you'd have to ask your diocesan staff or ask your bishop. Say, are we doing parish audits? Say, hey, bishop, I heard that 40% of the dioceses were not implementing parish audits, and the NRB really strongly recommends that be done. Are we doing parish audits?
Mm-hmm.
Are you one of the clean bishops or one of the dirty bishops? Well, maybe that language isn't the best language, but, you know, are we or are we not? The same thing with regard to background checks and ongoing training.
Mm-hmm.
What would be great is if someone with the means wanted to aggregate this information and could just systematically ask bishops, do you or don't you, and report it and let us know. That would shine some more light on that.
Exactly.
That's the idea of the audit report, but it's really falling short. One of the great weaknesses of the whole audit system is that it only reports aggregate national percentages. In a way, it shields those dioceses and bishops that are not complying with all the recommendations fully. Why are we doing that? I don't know. I don't want to use the word cover up, but it seems that a rational reporting system would tell us in the spirit of an audit where the problems are. We don't know where the problems are.
Exactly. Exactly.
So it's
that shining of the light. And I think this is, and to be quite honest, we should not be afraid of it either. We, as the laity, I think we've got a great duty to do here. You know, just like we go and ask the parish or the diocese, can we see your books? You know, what that type of thing.
Yeah.
Even more so, we should be asking about these types are you compliant with these audits, because this is even more damaging if fraud is one thing, but oh my goodness gracious, this is life changing for people who are involved
in
this.
It should be in a positive spirit.
Exactly.
What we do know is
that most
bishops and most dioceses are doing a good job, and we should be willing to commend those.
Absolutely.
Wouldn't it be great to say, look at all these bishops that are doing such a great job. Why aren't the others?
And if yours is one of those ones, celebrate it and make sure that people understand that yours is one of those places. And if it's not, work with your diocese so that you can make this. Father Sullins, it's been absolutely wonderful. It always goes by so quick whenever I speak with you because all the information is, we are praying for you, because I know this has to be tough.
Thank you as
a Catholic priest, having to go through all of this must be heartbreaking, but you still do it. So God bless you for what you're doing. We really appreciate it.
Thank you, Molly. Right, God bless you.
You've just been listening to Father Paul Sullins and Molly Smith discussing clerical sexual abuse and misconduct in the Catholic Church. The most recent USCCB audit is the subject of Father Sullins' latest report, linked on our website and in the show notes. This podcast is a rebroadcast of a segment of Salem Radio's From the Median. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization equipping effective advocates for family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. Like us on Facebook, check out the site, and subscribe to our weekly newsletter to stay informed.